Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Cosmic Logos, Book 3 of the Celestial Triad, written by Traci Harding and read by Benedict Hardie. The dedication reads, "To those who guide the future, the master rays of the cosmic logos, from whence all imagination, inspiration, and wisdom comes." In the ancient future, there was an echo in time when the masters of reality were called forth to record a chronicle of ages with the aid of the Tablet of Destinies and serve the divine purpose of the great cosmic logos. Acknowledgements. At last, the final installment of this triad/series has arrived. As per usual, there are many to whom I owe my gratitude for making this book happen, so here goes. Firstly, I must thank my poor, overworked husband, David, who has gone well out of his way to ensure I had the time to write this tale and put up with my grumpy moods as I struggled to process all the heavy research material. Many blessings to my nanny, Mo, and my mother, Tony, for taking care of my daughter, Sarah, while I grabbed some time in front of the computer. On the research front, I must thank my new friend, Diana, for introducing me to the Reverend Michael King of the Melchizedek Synthesis Light Academy, www.aussiemsla.com. Michael aided me with some of the heavy research and was kind enough to proofread this manuscript. The Reverend's assistance is most appreciated. I must also thank Dr. Joshua Stone, www.drjoshuadavidstone.com, for his kind invitation to the Vesak celebration in California this year. I greatly look forward to the experience. I must also take time here to credit my clairvoyant, another Michael, must be something in the name, whose insight and words of guidance have contributed greatly to these tales over the years and to my life. Next, my gratitude goes to the great gang of people who have been frequenting the message board at my new website, which the HarperCollins multimedia team set up for me this year. Diana, Sautia, Rob, Callie, Karina, Claire, Michelle, Olivia, Melissa, Sharon, Carita, Rebecca, Christine, Becky, Amanda, Gwyn, Chi, Hayes, Fiona, Annie, Stami, Leah, Lee, and all the other regular message posters, many thanks for your wonderful support, ideas, views, stories, poems, and encouragement. Also to our fairy webmother, Deb, a big chug on the shoulder for a job well done, and thanks to Andrew, Laura, and Fiona for their assistance as well. Thanks too to all those readers who have emailed me during the years that this series has been in publication. Your feedback has been invaluable. To that wonderful gang of authors at the Sassy Net, I thank you also for your words of wisdom and for sharing your experience. Kim Wilkins, Ian Irvine, Graham Haig, Louise Cusack, Richard Harland, Tess Williams, and all our new members too. You are wonderful authors, and I highly recommend you to all readers. I cannot credit this esteemed list of colleagues without crediting our fearless leader and agent, Selwa Anthony. Words cannot express how much I owe and adore this woman. She is my idol, my friend, and my guiding light. Speaking of guiding lights, thanks to my editors, Sue and Steph, for negotiating a tighter editing schedule than usual, as this tale was a real monster to write and took longer than usual. I'm sure readers appreciate your efforts to get this tale to the bookstores as soon as possible. As for the rest of the team at HarperCollins, especially Linda and Midge, what can I say but it's been a real pleasure, and I look forward to working with you all for many, many years to come. Part 1. Planets. Prologue. She had an idea for a new film script, which had been evolving for some time now. The heroine was a martial artist misplaced in time. The main character had been a hero originally, but she'd rethought this idea, considering that it would prove far more challenging and interesting if the warrior hero was a female. Such a woman would be able to physically defend herself, no matter which of history's dark ages the writer decided to cast her into. Speaking of the dark ages, the writer was very interested in this period of British history. Still, the last thing the world needed was another Arthurian tale, even if this one would have a rather strange twist. According to the few historians writing during the purported era of Arthur's rule, like Bede, Gildas, and Nennius, King Arthur and his Knights of the Round Table had never existed, as the legend had failed to score so much as a mention in the histories of the time. Merlin, or rather Myrthin, was documented as having aided King Ambrosius to victory over the Roman tyrant Vortigern. Could the former have been the true Arthur? Even if he had been, this tale had also been done to death by novelists over the past few centuries. What this writer wanted was a new hero, with a new legend to tell. There must have been mighty kings who performed the great deeds and fought the bloody battles that had long since been attributed to Arthur. The writer made a mental note to seek out more research material on the early kings of Britain during her forthcoming trip to the UK. She wasn't too sure how her as-yet-nameless heroine had become misplaced in time. The date and place of her transcendental episode of biolocation was still a mystery. The writer supposed that the answer to this conundrum would be answered during a good research session at some distant point in time. Work had begun on her second serious attempt at a film script, and the tale was proving to be rather intriguing, immersed as she was in the realms of the denizens of the nature kingdoms. Still, all her writing was going to be put on hold for the next month or so, as she was off to the UK to raise interest in her first attempt at a feature film. She was also going to view locations and get costings on the section of the film that would have to be shot in the UK. This film explored past lives and karma, and although much of the footage could be shot in Australia, it was hard to fake a castle. And why would you want to, when the UK had so many breathtaking castles on offer? Appointments with the relevant custodians had been made in advance to view the locations, as it was the middle of the cold season and thus estates were closed to the public. It would have been nice to have been able to hold out and visit the UK during a more accommodating season, but the Gulf War had driven the price of a ticket overseas to an all-time low, so for the young and rather broke film writer, opportunity beckoned. Chapter 1. The Appointed. Knowledge dwells in heads replete with the thoughts of other men, wisdom in the minds attentive to their own. An insightful thought from one of Gaia's 15th century philosophers. Noah stopped short of naming the source, noting that one of his students was eager to supply the information. Yes, Avery?
The Honourable Francis Bacon, and Noah,
the blonde-haired lad with the twinkling violet eyes responded.
Exactly right,
Noah stated, proud of his student's firm grasp of the human history of the planet that Avery's forefathers had called home.
I felt this was an appropriate quote with which to conclude your tuition, for, with all the lessons I have given you, you alone can transmute that knowledge into wisdom. And I am confident that each of you will do exactly that.
The sage broke from his formal address to approach each of his 5 graduates in turn. The first of these was a fiery young leonine female named Bast, who was as unique in character as she was in appearance. Her dark, straight hair and piercing blue eyes made her one of a kind among her people. But her abundance of pure-hearted, amorous charm was fast marking her as the most desirable single female alive. The fact that she was heiress to the Leonine Kingdom and was to be the voice of her people in Lahmu's Senate only added to her eligibility.
Dear Bast, Noah began, smiling broadly as he took up her left hand and held it in his. His right hand enfolded the three-sided pyramid, engraved with ancient hieroglyphs, which hung on a chain around his neck. This ancient divining tool was known as the Tablet of Destinies, and had been a gift to the sage's first human incarnation from the divine logos, Anu. It had been handed down through the ages to each of the guardians of mankind, and had found its way back into his possession 20 years ago, when Noah's superconscious link to the cosmic logos had been restored. Before you leave our fair planet to assume the governorship of New Gaia, my parting advice for you is... He allowed himself a graceful pause, which amused his students greatly. This was a game that they had played throughout their schooling, which was nothing more than good old fortune-telling. Noah had learned to make his guidance fun, lest it go unheeded. The prophet would give his students one insight into their future each year, and at some time within that year, a situation would arise where the advice could be put to good use.
"Don't tease me and Noah," Bast implored him, dying to know the prediction.
"Although men will be falling all over themselves to court you, Bast, true happiness lies with a man whom you will have to pursue," he concluded, inspiring a round of applause and laughter from the other four students, who knew the Leonine lady well. Bast screwed up her nose, disappointed.
"I won't be interested in a serious relationship for years, but even so, I was kind of hoping he'd be tall, handsome, and courageous, not forbidding."
"Courage would be a must," agreed Avery.
"All right," Noah cautioned him, ahead of turning back to Bast. "Don't be blinded by glamour, Nin. Physical beauty can be a great deceiver and can only bring a fleeting happiness, for all physical beauty will perish in time."
Bast sat tall in her seat, and, crossing her legs, she placed both hands on her hips.
"Not my beauty," she debated in fun,
her black lion's tail twitching playfully as she spoke.
"We chosen are immortal, and thus eternally young and beautiful, are we not?"
Noah's mouth curved into a half smile, as he realized that she was still too new to the physical world to appreciate the argument he was trying to put forward.
"Nothing in the whole of creation remains the same forever, Bast. If it did, all would be stagnant. One day, even you shall tire of your physical form, as becoming as it is."
Although Bast couldn't imagine ever feeling as Noah described, there were some among the Chosen who were losing their affinity with physical plane existence, such as Avery's and Lirithia's parents.
"Perhaps I should have said I am looking for a man who is wise, loving, and true, and Noah,"
the Leonine female resolved, knowing what her tutor would want to hear.
"That would serve you better, Bast," he agreed, "but only if that is what you truly will for yourself. What I want for you will have very little effect in your reality."
"Point taken," Bast conceded, a little ashamed for attempting to fool En-Noah.
He always knew when he was being mocked. The sage moved on to the verbal extrovert of the class.
"I know what life holds in store, for I am the force behind my own manifestation," Avery stated proudly. "But any advice you or the Tablet of Destinies may have for this soon-to-be otherworldly lord, En-Noah, shall surely prove insightful."
Avery was apprenticed to Gwyn Afneath, the current guardian of the otherworld. Too much of the lord's confidence and mischievous nature had rubbed off on the youth during his tuition. For, although Avery had proven himself very adept at commanding wisely the various inhabitants of the etheric realm, he had a tendency to be far cockier than an older, wiser man might be. Noah gripped Avery's hand and advised,
"You have many selves on many different levels of existence, all pouring energy into your manifestation. If you are putting out the right messages, then they shall surely heed your will. But beware what you will to manifest.
Is that the prediction?
Avery queried. Noah shook his head.
My advice is this. When your words conflict with what is in your heart, know that a great rivalry will be avoided by putting your ego aside and telling the truth.
Ooh,
Avery's fellow students murmured, thinking that the prophecy was a rather ominous one.
Shall I be rewarded for telling the truth?
Avery wasn't satisfied. He wanted something to look forward to. Noah smiled a knowing smile.
The truth always brings its
own rewards,
Avery concluded in unison with his tutor. Having studied under the sage for 20 years now, he knew Noah's predictable response to his stupid question.
I walked right into that one.
Noah raised both eyebrows in agreement before moving on to Lirithea, Avery's twin sister and his opposite in most regards. Avery liked action, whilst Lirithea personified tranquility. He was forthright, self-promoting and mischievous, whereas she was meditative, selfless and as close to a saint as anyone Noah had ever known. They did look remarkably alike, however. White blonde hair and violet eyes were traits the twins inherited from their infamous mother, Tory Alexander. Avery had his parents' warrior form, and Lirithea had a body that was waif-like, which she commanded with all the grace of a prima ballerina. Her vocation in life was also otherworldly. Where her brother would soon command the denizens living in the etheric realms, Lirithea had an affinity with the spirits in the higher mental realm and beyond. In days of old, the young woman would have been regarded as a priestess or a druidess, but Lirithea preferred the term oracle. Both brother and sister were to assume seats on Lahmu's council. Avery was to represent the other world, and Lirithea would be the voice of the spirit world.
You are probably more adept at soothsaying than I am these days, Lirithea,
Noah granted, as he came to a stop in front of the angelic maiden.
Please state my fate according to the tablet, Noah, for although I have many guides, you are one of those whose advice I most cherish.
Lirithea had an expectant smile as she offered her hand to the sage to participate in the game.
Ah,
he teased her in fun, and she cowered behind the long, fine hair that fell dead straight to her waist, suddenly sorry she'd insisted.
Being born perfect is a curse,
Noah continued, cracking a gracious smile.
For a state obtained must be maintained, and herein lies your challenge. Do what you must without regret, and thus conserve your energy for grander pursuits. Never feel sorry for knowing your own mind and the will of the Logos.
Lirithea was rather enchanted by his counsel.
I shall do my best, Noah.
And that has always proven more than sufficient, he said gently.
Sparrowhawk, as always, was alongside Lirithea, and although the younger falcon male was only her half-brother, he had far more in common with Lirithea than her twin brother did. From different human tribes, one never would have guessed them to be of the same family, but their mother's violet eyes made their kinship more obvious. This set Sparrowhawk apart from his breed, for he was the only falcon who had pupils of such colour. The lad inherited the deep brown wings that sprouted from his back and the shoulder-length quills of the same colour that grew on his head from his father, Hawk, an infamous space pirate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.